Good afternoon. My name is Karen Stern. I'm the clinical pharmacist at Pascack Valley Medical Center, and I'm really excited to speak to you today about pain management and how to have, you know, a more open and honest conversation, and I think therefore a more effective conversation with your provider. The goal of my presentation today is to empower you with an understanding of pain, answering questions such as how prevalent is pain and how do we reconcile the benefits and the risks of opioid use to treat pain. We'll also spend quite a bit of time understanding the mechanics of pain, that there are different sources and types of pain that warrant different treatment modalities, ranging from opioids to no medications at all. With that knowledge in hand, you will be able to have a more effective conversation with your provider, to construct the best pain management plan for you. All right, so let's take a look at some statistics revolving around the prevalence of pain. According to the CDC, chronic pain is one of the most common reasons adults seek medical care. In a November 2020 data brief from 2019, it showed that 20.4%, or about 50 million adults, had chronic pain, with 7.4% of adults experiencing pain that frequently limited life or work activities. Prevalence of chronic pain increased with age, higher amongst non-Hispanic white adults, women, and in rural areas of residence. Chronic pain and high-impact chronic pain are associated with, according to the study, decreased quality of life, opioid dependence, and poor mental health. The National Institute of Health also published a press release. This was from back in 2015, titled, "The NIH analysis shows that Americans are in pain. 40 million adults experienced severe levels of pain," according to the press release, and severe pain was associated with worse health status. So we can see, you know, from these studies and these numbers, right, that pain is something very real and does in fact impact our physical and mental health. Okay, so now let's take a look at the statistics around the use of opioids. Since this class of pain medications is talked about and reported on very often. So the CDC reported that about every day, more than 1,000 people are treated in emergency departments for misusing prescription opioids. And more than 40 people die from prescription opioid overdoses. Again, that's every day. The report also shared that even just 3 days of opioid treatment can increase the likelihood of chronic opioid use. I found that very interesting. Opioids were involved in nearly 50,000 deaths in 2019, which was over 6 times the number of opioid-involved overdose deaths in 1999. So, you know, we hear statistics on the prevalence of pain, how common it is, how debilitating it can be. And then we have, you know, statistics on, you know, such a common class of pain medications, and it can be really challenging to reconcile the two. And, you know, you might be thinking, right, why would anyone even use these? So we're gonna, you know, answer that question in a little bit. So where does this leave us, right? You may be wondering, should I take opioids if they are prescribed for my pain? Are there other medications that are effective for treating pain? Are medications the only option for managing pain? Right? And it could be you have, you know, other questions as well. So remember, from the statistics we looked at, I just want you to take away that persistent uncontrolled pain can adversely affect our health. And a deeper understanding about the physiology of pain is really key to appropriate pain management. Okay, so factors to consider, you know, when assessing pain. So first is the classification, like the site of your pain. Is it widespread? Is it neuropathic? Like, does it affect your nerves? Is this pain that's post-surgical? Is it cancer-related pain? Is it a headache? Is it in your muscles? Right, then there are also temporal aspects of pain to consider, like how often does it happen? Is it acute? Is it chronic? Do you experience this, have you experienced this for a long time? Right, chronic and ongoing, or is it intermittent? It comes and goes throughout the day, right? And then we also have the assessment of the pain intensity. How severe is it? Other coexisting conditions that may be exacerbating the pain, psychological functioning, physical functioning, and social aspects that may be affecting your level of pain. Okay, so now taking a little bit of a deeper dive into the physiology of pain. So these are the steps involved in pain signaling and processing. The general cascade of pain signaling begins with transduction, where sensory is translated into electricity, like a pain sensation is translated into electricity, similar to how a radio transduces radio waves into sound waves. The next step is conduction, where pain sensation moves from our peripheral to central nervous system. Think about when heat from a hot cooking pan is conducted from the pan to a metal spoon touching the inside of the pan. Right? Then next is transmission, where the electric signal is converted into neurotransmitters such as glutamate, norepinephrine, or dopamine. And you can compare that to when, like, television signals are transmitted over open air to a receiver television. Once the pain signal reaches our brain, we then perceive and experience the pain. The last step is pain modulation, where the brain adjusts pain signals away from the brain or through the descending pathway. The previous steps occur on the way up to the brain or via the ascending pathway. So pain really travels through the body as chemical signals, as electric and chemical signals coming from the site where the pain is generating and up to our brains. So these pain-related neurohormones or signals are released at various points throughout the body and play a really important role in facilitating the other organ system's response to that experience of pain. Here I want to go through the pathways involved with pain transmission and potential non-opioid treatments that we can use to target those pain pathways. Because again, when we talk about pain management, right, our goal is to tackle the various pathways involved in these transmissions of these pain signals that are traveling throughout the body. So you can see here, I know the might be a little difficult to see some of the names of the medications in this diagram. That's why I have the table on the right to show you that some of these medications that are actually quite commonly used are very effective at targeting various pain pathways. For example, aspirin, right, and other non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, right, those target the pain pathway that is started off by an inflammatory process. We also have antidepressants. That's actually quite an interesting one. Antidepressants can play a really important role in certain kinds of pain by reducing pain in those who do and do not have depression. Their role in analgesia is not fully understood, but may be related to the serotonin, norepinephrine, pain inhibitory pathways and other pathways involved in pain signaling transmission as well. Other medications like antiepileptics, they lower neurotransmitter release or reduction of neuronal firing. They act on voltage-gated calcium channels. Now, I know this is really getting into like the nitty-gritty, right, of what these drugs are doing when helping us treat pain. But my point in listing all these various pain receptors and neurotransmitters is to really make the point that there are many different chemical pathways involved in pain. And you can see from here that different drugs play different roles in tackling, right, the different pathways. You don't have one drug that's good at tackling all the pathways, and therefore, right, you wouldn't have one drug that would be successful at treating all kinds of pain. So this treatment table, right, of non-opioid analgesics that can be used for acute and chronic pain was actually taken from a New England Journal of Medicine study. And what I wanted to highlight from here and show you was that certain medications that are not what we would not typically think of for being used for pain, like duloxetine, that's an antidepressant, is actually first line treatment for neuropathic pain. Or gabapentin, that's also first line treatment for neuropathic pain. We have, fortunately, many different classes of drugs at our disposal to use to create more effective pain management treatment plans for our patients. There are actually some great resources out there that I really encourage everybody to take a look at. This is actually an example from the CDC's website. They have a homepage for the treatment of acute pain, common forms of pain, acute pain that are experienced, and how they can be most effectively treated. And what I found very interesting was, right, these are conditions where, you know, we may often find opioids being prescribed for, where in fact, non-opioids, medications like acetaminophen, the brand name being Tylenol, or ibuprofen, right, the brand name being Motrin, those are really going to be your cornerstones of therapy. Like, for example, here, like you can see, I have highlighted in the top right an example of treatment recommendations for acute migraine. Right, you can see in that red box, it says, because of the lack of evidence demonstrating efficacy and concern about subacute or long-term sequelae, injectable morphine and hydromorphone, right, those are examples of opioids, are best avoided as first-line therapy, right? And then they go on to say that there are other medications that are actually, you know, the route to go that would be considered first-line. And then in the box below as well, in their recommendation for post-operative pain, right, you can see it suggests as well, it says routine opioid use for treatment of non-severe acute pain is not recommended. So I definitely, again, encourage everybody to take a look. There are also other conditions such as, dental pain, how to manage, ankle sprains. And this can be a really good, you know, reference for you, just to also know, you know, like what to expect and what kind of questions to ask your provider, you know, should you need to go into your doctor's office and get some help managing any acute pain that you're experiencing. So we spoke a little bit about non-opioids, right? Your NSAIDs, Tylenol, you know, other medications that can be used and should be used as first line, right? And now we have opioids, right? We spoke about the statistics earlier and how, you know, they cause, you know, overdose deaths. And let's take a second to also understand the role of opioids in pain management. We said before that we would talk about, okay, so, you know, if they are dangerous and can be habit forming, right? Why are they used, right? Because they're very potent and effective. Opioids bind to and activate opioid receptors on cells found in the brain, spinal cord, and other organs in the body that produce pleasurable effects and relieve pain. At times, opioids can relieve pain that is unaffected by other medications. As we mentioned earlier, right, opioids are habit-forming medications. They should also be used to treat more severe forms of pain. many unwanted side effects are found with this particular class of drugs, you know, including, and I just listed a couple over here, drowsiness, nausea, vomiting, constipation, respiratory depression, itching. And the development of addiction has biological, psychological, and social contributing factors. According to the CDC opioid prescribing guidelines, opioids are not first-line therapy for chronic pain. If the benefits of use outweigh the risk, they should be used as part of a multimodal pain management strategy that includes non-pharmacological methods such as exercise, physical therapy, and non-opioids. Okay, so continuing on with the role of opioids in pain management, I actually found it, you know, pretty interesting. The American Society of Anesthesiologists put out a study called Multimodal Approach to Pain Management Reduces Opioid Use and Prescriptions After a Joint Replacement. They focused on the fact that opioids should be used as part of a multimodal pain management plan, as opioids may have a role to play, right, in effective pain management, meaning that if an opioid is necessary, the level of pain is so severe, that might be a good choice, but it should be part of a bigger picture. There should be other medications on board to provide pain relief. And an example of a time when an opioid really may be beneficial, they mentioned, right, is during and immediately after surgery. A multimodal approach was associated with decreased opioid use, opioid prescriptions, and common opioid-related complications in patients undergoing total hip or knee replacement. Patients who received more than two methods of pain, meaning, you know, two different classes of drugs to relieve pain, in addition to opioids, had 19% fewer respiratory complications, 26% fewer gastrointestinal complications, and 12% decrease in hospital length of stay, right? So what does that spell out? They had a more improved recovery from their surgery by using less opioid. Okay, now let's move on to the last piece of our multimodal pain management plan. We spoke about non-opioids, again, such as Tylenol, Motrin, again, and other agents, anti-epileptics, antidepressants. I mean, even though those would be used for more neuropathic, like nerve-related pain. We spoke a little bit about opioids. Those are very, very potent medications used to treat severe pain. Now we also have non-pharmacologic pain management or not using medication, right? So what role does this play? How effective is it? And, you know, on this slide I have listed here, you know, different kinds of non-pharmacologic interventions that we can do. For example, exercise and physical activity. There was actually a 2017 Cochrane review that encompassed 21 reviews with 381 included studies and 37,143 participants. So we're talking about, you know, analyzing and looking at a lot of data. And they found that physical activity and exercise for chronic pain are interventions that may improve pain severity, physical function, and consequent quality of life. Another example of a non-pharmacologic intervention is cognitive behavioral therapy, right? And what cognitive behavioral therapy really is, you know, focusing on changing the way that you think about pain, that you view pain. And when we do that, our body and mind can be better prepared to respond to episodes of pain. And, you know, examples of cognitive behavioral therapy include yoga, meditation, or muscle relaxation. The National Center for Complementary and Integrative Health, which is actually, you know, like a subdivision of the NIH, the National Institute for Health, shows that a growing body of evidence suggests approaches such as acupuncture, hypnosis, massage, mindful meditation, spinal manipulation, and yoga may have some benefit for chronic pain. Acupuncture actually was shown to reduce a patient's need for opioids. The quality of the evidence and reported efficacy amongst the studies looking at these different approaches may vary, but it, again, can be useful as part of a multimodal approach when you're using more than one way to treat pain. Now, another non-pharmacologic form of pain management that I actually do get asked about quite a bit, right? Medical marijuana. I can share with you what information we have out there. It may be helpful for chronic pain. And you'll see later on in the slide deck why I say may be helpful. The American Academy of Neurology, their 2019 annual meeting, right, they shared a preliminary study that showed that cannabis provided elderly patients with relief from chronic pain, sleep disorders, and anxiety, along with other conditions. Some studies show cannabinoids may diminish opioid requirements for analgesia, right? Meaning that it can potentially decrease the amount of opioids required to effectively treat pain. However, and this is a big however, this finding is not conclusive, and higher quality studies failed to confirm an opioid sparing effect. The overall place of medical marijuana in the treatment of chronic pain as well as other conditions really has yet to be determined. Further research is needed that meets FDA requirements for determining safety and efficacy in pain management. You know, so again, we don't have all the evidence that we need to really say that, yes, this is safe, this is effective. We know at what point in pain management we should be using this. So there are definitely quite a few unknowns associated with using medical marijuana. And should this discussion, you know, come up at a point, you know, in treating pain, it's really, really important to have that benefit versus risk assessment, you know, done with your provider, really, you know, weighing the benefit and the risk. Because again, there are quite a few unknowns associated. Cannabinoids are not a benign substance and carry side effects as well as drug interactions. And it can be habit forming. So again, that, you know, is definitely of concern. Medical marijuana is legal for medical use in some states, but is still federally prohibited. And the reason for that being that, you know, the point we mentioned earlier of not having enough quality evidence showing safety and efficacy in treatment for chronic pain. So now that, you know, you have a lot more knowledge about pain, right? How pain travels throughout the body, that there are different chemical pathways involved in it. And because of that, there are, right, are different kinds of medications to treat pain. And how important it is that we use different kinds of medication to attack pain. Now, right, we are hopefully more prepared to having a, you know, discussion with our providers on how to best manage your pain. And, you know, before I get into, you know, points to discuss, and you can see I have here on top, that you and your doctor both play an important role in managing your pain, right? You are a partner in making your pain management treatment plan a success. So when talking to your provider about your pain, be sure to really describe it. The severity, the site, possible triggers of your pain. When did you start feeling this pain? be clear on how and if your pain limits your daily activities. That's really important. Disclose any medications that you've tried, because that will really help guide your provider on what an appropriate next step for you might be. Also really important, review your home medication list. You'd be surprised. Sometimes pain can be medication induced. And it's also really important to share your medication list with your provider so you can avoid unnecessary drug-drug interactions. Express your knowledge about the effectiveness of multimodal pain, asking about opioid versus non-opioid or even non-pharmacologic modalities, right? What is an effective combination for your pain? And, you know, something that I think is really important is like, you know, if you see that you are just being offered, you know, one kind of medication or one treatment modality, I think it's really important to ask, you know, is there anything else that I can do, you know, to relieve this pain? Because I know that, you know, when we use a combination of methods to treat pain, it can sometimes be more effective. Always ask about the risk versus the benefit for any prescribed or suggested medication, you know, for pain, even not for pain, but, you know, for the sake of our conversation today, you know, for any pain medication, you know, be it opioid or a non-opioid medication. And is this the best fit for your type of pain? Right? If someone is experiencing like more of a numbing and tingling sensation in their fingers that can be very uncomfortable, but you know, and it's a sensation like that many times can be caused by, you know, a nerve associated pain. And an opioid or just, you know, an ibuprofen really might not be a good fit. And also, it's really, you know, I think very beneficial to ask that, you know, is there a topical medication that's available? Topical medications such as, you know, gel, like an example would be the Voltaren gel, right? That's a non-steroidal anti-inflammatory gel. The benefit of topical medications versus something oral is that there are usually a lot fewer systemic side effects with topical medications. So that, you know, is definitely of benefit to you. And I definitely think it's worthwhile to ask, you know, is there something that I can use topically, be it, you know, a medicated patch or gel or hot and cold compresses, you know, even though those are not medications, but, you know, something that you can ask about, you know, to limit your exposure to systemic side effects. Okay. And, you know, if the conversation, you know, about your pain and the kind of pain you're experiencing does point to, you know, needing to use an opioid, you know, in addition to the points that we just mentioned about, you know, asking about risk versus benefit, it's really, really important when we're talking about, you know, opioid use to really map out a plan. How long am I going to need to use this for? Opioids really should be used, you know, again, and I'm not talking about in certain kinds of chronic pain, let's say cancer-associated pain. I'm talking about more, you know, like acute forms of pain or post-surgery, or even for more, you know, non-opioid dependent forms of chronic pain. Opioids should be viewed more of as a bridging medication to help you get through a certain, you know, acute, severe pain that you're experiencing right now. And, you know, hoping with the hope that we can transition to using either other non-opioid medications to effectively treat your pain or, you know, again, non-pharmacologic methods. And again, establishing a multimodal pain management plan, you know, again, with having a non-opioid on board, with having, you know, non-pharmacologic methods in place, such as exercise, physical therapy, And the reason, again, multimodal pain management is so important is because it can potentially limit opioid use and duration. It can help us create a transition plan from opioid use. And it's also really important to discuss, you know, what other methods can you use, you know, when transitioning off of an opioid to help compensate for the analgesia from the opioid. And also ask your provider to clarify your prescription instructions if needed. Really make sure that you can repeat back correctly the dose and the frequency. How often should you be taking it? What kind of pain scale or what kind of, you know, feelings of pain should you be taking that for? Okay, so remember, untreated, unrelenting pain can negatively impact your physical and mental health. Pain comes in different shapes and sizes, right? And I say that again because of the different chemical pathways involved in pain, and also because of the different locations of our pain, right? A first-line medication used to treat a headache would not be the same as a first-line agent used to treat muscle pain. Think of pain medications as a lock and key, right? Not one size fits all. Opioids do have their place in therapy, but unfortunately are prescribed unnecessarily for types of pain that they're not even ideal to treat. And along with that, right, comes exposing somebody to many unwanted and potentially very dangerous side effects. Discuss your pain openly and honestly with your provider. I can't stress enough the importance of asking questions. Don't be embarrassed or shy to ask or to explain or to say, you know what I'm using is not helping my pain. Multimodal pain management, and I really hope this is one of the key most important take-home points. Multimodal pain management is an effective way to treat pain, right? When we are targeting multiple chemical pathways involved in the transmission of pain signals throughout our body, it is just that much more effective than instead of just targeting one and trying to target and hit one pathway really hard. We can decrease the burden on that one, targeting that one pathway, and target several pathways, right? So when you're doing that, if you're using a couple different medications to target your pain, then you can potentially use lower doses, exposing yourself to less side effects. And again, you know, using multiple medications at times may not be warranted. Again, depending on the nature, severity, type of pain. I don't want to make this again a one size fits all, but asking and talking about multimodal pain is really important because I think it can be very effective in treating pain, you know, more often than we may think. And it is a really good point to bring up with your provider. So I hope I gave you the tools or some of the tools and references, you know, that you need to help you have that more open and honest conversation. And really, pain is not a one size fits all. So it's really important, you know, again, to talk about different options, what works for you and your lifestyle, and, you know, based on the other medications that you're taking or other conditions that you may have, because having that open and honest conversation can really help your provider make a plan that is, you know, tailored to you and the, you know, hopefully the most effective for you. Thanks so much for joining me today. Please share any questions if you have. Okay, thank you so much. Have a great day.